As the coronavirus pandemic swept across the globe, relegating workers to their home offices or kitchen tables or beds, happy hours to the digital sphere, and classes to a webinar format, society has been forced to grapple with the intricacies of digital interaction. While the shortcomings of the Zoom happy hour have been thoroughly documented, there's one aspect of the video chat that needs more attention. It's extremely odd, and even off-putting, to constantly stare at your own face when you're conversing with other people. Try as you might to stare into your laptop camera, it's difficult to not look at the video of your face in the corner of your computer or phone screen. Whether it's to analyze your own reactions to colleagues or to simply find solace among a hyperstimulating medium, gazing at your own image on video calls is hardly a novel phenomenon. I think it's a very normal reaction, says Doreen Dodgen-McGee, PsyD, a psychologist and author of Deviced. Balancing life and technology in a digital world. There's a novelty to this new experience, to witness ourselves in a new way. But what impact does all this time spent staring at our faces have on our psyche? In ordinary circumstances, people may ready themselves in the mirror prior to departing in the morning and then not face their reflection much or at all throughout the day. But with a work and social calendar dominated by FaceTimes and Zooms, we're constantly confronted with our visage, Dodgen-McGee says. By design, video chats provide a lot to look at and process, our co-worker's living room, a presenter's hand gestures, our best friend's new puppy, all within a few on-screen pixels. All these faces can cause enough stress in our brains to trigger a fight or flight response. When a barrage of large faces continually populate your screen, such as in the active speaker mode on Zoom, our brain interprets those faces as being physically close to ours, and research shows we tend to recoil from those virtual faces. Keeping our eyes fixed on our own reflection can feel stress-relieving in this high-stimuli environment, says Tara Well, PhD, an associate professor of psychology at Barnard College of Columbia University who researches mirrors and reflections. You look at yourself, and think, at least I know I'm there, Well says. I can control what I'm doing. I can't control what anybody else is doing on this call. Lacking in virtual hangouts, Well continues, is the notion of co-regulation, the process of feeding off of your conversation partner's emotions to determine your own appropriate reactions. For example, attempting to cheer up your friend when you notice they're sad. People can miss some physical cues on Zoom, like slouched shoulders or hand wringing, and may have difficulty co-regulating with others on virtual hangouts, Well says. It's much easier to read your own emotions by peering at your own video feed. Does your facial expression feel appropriate for the moment or conversation? If not, you can adjust. Studying our own facial expressions can also be helpful in determining how we actually feel. One of the reasons we like looking at ourselves in the mirror is it's familiar and it's a way we can co-regulate, Well says, because we're giving ourselves immediate feedback on how we're feeling in the moment. Just like the impulse to glance at your reflection in a car or boutique window, a totally normal instinct, Well says, looking at yourself on Zoom may reveal deeper emotional truths about how you're feeling currently, anxious, frustrated, she says. Consciously seeing our image, in a way, takes us out of the flow because it makes us disconnected from the other person and also from the task. On top of that, just like the surprise and dissonance of hearing a recording of your voice, watching yourself on video can have a similar effect, Well says, eliciting a "Do I really look like this?" reaction. While some people may be critical or self-conscious of their appearance, Well stresses the importance of building confidence and comfort in this externalized version of yourself, and if catching your own eye in a Zoom call helps with that, it's hardly narcissistic. It sounds corny, but the longest relationship you have is with yourself, she says. Another reason we have difficulty peeling our eyes away from our FaceTime box is the simple fact that our likeness can be distracting. A 2009 study found that when looking at a series of photos of people's faces, including their own, people in the study found it difficult to disengage attention away from their own faces. Our visage may be distracting because it's familiar. According to a 2006 study, we argue that the emotional value or the high familiarity of one's own face may explain its attention-grabbing property, the researchers wrote. This element of distraction can prevent us from being fully immersed in our online yoga class or work presentation. Consciously seeing our image, in a way, takes us out of the flow because it makes us disconnected from the other person and also from the task, says Julie Anses, PhD, a professor and inaugural director of cyberpsychology at New Jersey Institute of Technology. Thanks to selfie culture and the desire to put our best digital face forward on social media, we're already acutely attuned to how we present to others, Anses notes. Both self-consciousness or narcissism could drive one to keep monitoring their video display on a Zoom call. The line between simple curiosity and narcissism when looking at your own video feed is the overt feeling that you look better than everyone, Well says. The simple reminder that someone is watching us perpetuates this focus on ourself, Anses says. What are other people thinking of us? Am I projecting what I want to be projecting? This constant self-judgment is one of the many documented reasons why Zoom calls are so draining, Dajan McGee says, especially for women, black people, and people of color who have more cultural expectations placed upon them to look certain ways. Because of these expectations to look and behave according to certain social standards, Dajan McGee is concerned these video-based interactions will contribute to feelings that we're not measuring up and that it's too hard to maintain our curated images of ourselves. Because we never watch our own reactions to conversations as they happen, video conferences provide a unique insight into how we operate in the world. However, Anses fears constantly looking at yourself on Zoom might encourage an external source of self-worth. We're also living in a really narcissistic world right now, she says. How good do I look to others? How popular am I? And that's where we're getting our self-worth. We need to find our self-worth in ourselves. If you're finding it hard to concentrate on anything besides your face during video chats, experts advise opting for the hide myself option in Zoom or covering your image on your screen with a sticky note. Anses suggests diligence in shifting your attention to the other people on your video call. If all else fails, remember that the only person hyper-focused on your video feed is you. All those other people, they're concerned with how they're looking, Anses says. They're focused on themselves, you're focused on yourself, we're all focused on ourselves.